the intuition according to Panika. If I may venture to be so bold as to describe Panika's metaphysical position, let me put it this way. In terms of what the intuition is, Panika's position comes close to that of Maritain. In Panika, intuition is called as the symbolic awareness or the perception of the third eye. Panika differs from Maritain in that he distinguishes between the concepts and the notions or ideas. For Panika, concepts are cut and dried straw, while the notions are open to the symbolic dimension. In terms of the worldview, Panika's position comes close to that of Nishida, especially regarding the positive evaluation of matter, or body. Although Maritain speaks about the dynamism of the knower becoming the semi-known in genuine knowledge, he seems to have retained the dichotomy of matter and spirit. Here, Panika makes a radical break from the traditional Christian, including the Thomist worldview at large. His study of the Vedic tradition brought him face to face with the ancient Indian view of the cosmos, in which gods are at once natural elements. His study of chemistry may have contributed some insight into the nature of matter. Matter is an irreducible part of reality for Panika. We read in his The Rhythm of Being, we cannot sense, think, and experience without matter, logos, and spirit. Thought and spiritual awareness are not possible without matter, indeed without the body. All our thoughts, words, state of consciousness, and the like are also material and have a material basis. Likewise, our mind would not have life, initiative, freedom, and indefinite scope, all metaphors, unless the spirit were lurking, as it were, behind or above, and matter were hiding underneath. This privileging of matter within the Christian tradition, Trinitarian context, characterizes Panika's spirituality, which embraces the three dimensions of the material, the reason, and the spiritual, or the religious. This is at the heart of his famous statement, I left as a Christian, found myself as a Hindu, and returned a Buddhist, without having ceased to be a Christian. So finally, I make a little observation of what this all pertains to what we are doing today. The intuition and intercultural studies. These subtle differences concerning what the intuition is seems to diffuse when it comes to the actual practice of how we understand the reality. Jacques Maritain has a fascinating passage that speaks of the emptying of the self, which comes so close to a Zen teaching. Maritain would be kicking, I think, somewhere if he's alive. We quote Maritain. It is as true to say that this intuition of being produces itself through the medium of the vital action of our intellect. I mean as vitally receptive and contemplative, as to say that we produce it. It is difficult in as much as it is difficult to arrive at the degree of intellectual purification at which this act is produced in us, at which we become sufficiently disengaged, sufficiently empty, to hear what all things whisper, and to listen instead of composing answers. We must attain a certain level of intellectual spirituality. In this connection, Panika speaks about the philosophical attitude in the cosmos-anthropic world, and Nishida speaks about the spirituality of immanent transcendence. In other words, the three thinkers agree on this attitude of listening. What we gain from the above inquiry is a path or methodology in engaging in intellectual intercultural studies. These three thinkers agree in one point. Follow your light as guided by intuition and be open to the rich realities that open up in front of you and know that you are already in the world.